get offended if I don't jump up there and get on the platform. I like to be down here with the real folks, if that's okay. Thank you, worship team. It was nice to be able just to relax and enjoy the Lord together and get our hearts engaged, our bodies engaged, some of us. You know, I see everybody jumping around up here. It's kind of good at the end of a week. Make sure everybody's, I had to look and see what you guys were carrying up here at first. I thought, okay, we're going to start off with a dead raise. Nope, that's a pulpit. I was like, all right, man, they're serious here. I said, oh, he's kind of ugly. Oh, no, that's just a pulpit. All right, well, that's good. Yeah, yeah. What happened to him? He must have got run over by a tractor trailer or something. Okay, well, that's good. My name is Andy Hayner, and I'm from Madison, Wisconsin. Been living there at least since 2000. Truthfully, I'm a missionary at heart, so I've moved around quite a bit. My wife and I figured out on our 10th anniversary that we had lived in 11 places in 10 years. So you guys know I have a good wife. Amen? I got a great wife. We've been married now for over 22 years. Her name is Tina. She homeschools all three of our children. We have Simeon, who's 16 years old, going out on his junior prom tonight. So that's exciting for him. I got a little text message with him all dudeed up, and man, he looks really good. He's a handsome young guy. And then Noelle is 15. She is my quiet, compassionate, artistic, piano playing, worship leading, songbird of a daughter. She can get a little bit feisty too. And Phoebe, she is with me, but she's out running around. Oh, there she is. She's made herself at home back in the sound booth. That's little Phoebe right there. Come on up here, sweetheart. She is, she came out, and when she was a baby, we nicknamed her Spitfire. Any of y'all that had babies, you could tell, right? If you've had more than one, you can tell they're different just by the way they cry. My son, I remember when we were in Turkey as missionaries, we had laid him back on the bed, and one of the kids of the house came out and said, "Mom and Dad, there's a baby roaring on our bed." So Simeon, he's a little bit more of a roarer. Noelle, she would whimper. But Phoebe, she'd go like that when she would cry. So we nicknamed her Spitfire, and that's kind of held true, hadn't it? You have one thing to say. Okay.
Both handicap signs and outside, you're going to have to take those down because there aren't going to be no handicapped people here anymore.
Amen. Amen. Well, we love Phoebe, and I'm glad she's here. She's going to be running the book table, so y'all prepared to get your wallets out, because this girl, she knows how to sell some books. You got to watch her, though, if you do a credit card purchase. We almost had a $25,000 sale. Make sure she puts that decimal point in the right place, okay? All right. Bless you, sweetie. Thank you. Okay. Well, it's good. Well, for those of you that do not know me, a little bit of my history. I grew up Roman Catholic and came to know Christ when I was in college. I was not looking for God in particular. He was looking for me, though. And I was trying to make sense out of life is all I was trying to do, because my thing, you know, sometimes you see people that their lives are so broken, they come to God. Well, on the outside, part of what was making me so broken is that I was succeeding at everything that I was trying to do, and I was still not happy. I had, you know, at that point succeeded. I mean, I'm still in college, but to be honest with you, you can, at all stages of life, you set goals, you achieve them, and I began to realize, you know, I was succeeding at everything. I had all the girlfriends I wanted. I had all the friends I wanted. I had all the grades I wanted. I had scholarship. I had all this stuff. I even dated Miss JSU, you know, at the college I went to. So I thought, you know, I was just getting bigger and bigger in my mind. But the problem was, I figured out that everything that you achieve makes you happy for a little bit, and then after a while it kind of gets old like everything else. You climb to the top of one ladder, you jump off that one, you are at the bottom of another one. And I could just see myself in this hamster circle just running and running and running, because I couldn't not succeed, but I was not happy with success. So after a while I just wanted off this circle. You know, and I'm praying about this one night. Not really. I actually had come home from doing what, as a Catholic, I knew was mortal sinning. And so I was like, you know, I had learned enough to pray that prayer of, if I die before I wake, please don't send me to hell, pretty much, you know. But they put it in a little poetry, you know. And I said, you know, God, I'm sorry, please don't, you know, send me to hell kind of thing. Or, you know, if I die before I wake, pray the Lord my soul to take. And then all of a sudden, it was like the presence. I was very aware that God was with me. And I had His attention. And He basically hacked my computer, so to speak, and started bringing thoughts to my mind that I was not originating. There was words coming up on my monitor that I wasn't typing. And I feel the presence of God come over me. And I have this voice go off in my head that says, tonight's Friday night, tomorrow night, Saturday night, you have the same thing planned with the same group of people. Who do you think you are fooling? Because that's what I had understood religion to be. It was just this system, you know. You kind of figure it out. There's do's and don'ts. You figure it out. And just like everything else, you figure out the system and you work it to your advantage, right? You know, so I wanted to be 51% good. That's what I wanted. Because all the stuff that I really enjoyed doing was, you know, over on the bad side. And, but I didn't, you know, I mean, who wants to, you know, go to hell forever? I mean, that's scary kind of thing. So I just had this system in my mind that I was going to work to my advantage. I had this thing figured out. And God showed up and told me personally, I didn't. Because God is not about religion. He's not a lawyer with loopholes. He's not a judge who can't do justice just because there was some technicality. We're not going to get off on some technicality. He showed up and said, I am not fooled. And I was humbled in the presence of Almighty God. And I thank God that it happened in my lifetime rather than after I died. You do not want to meet God when you die. You're all going to go stand before Him, right? But you don't want to meet Him when you die. You can meet Him right here. You can meet Him here and now. And that's really important. And so I was humbled and I said, What do I do? And I started thinking, you know, I need to get serious about this. I need to try harder. You know, I was going to turn over my fifth leaf. You know, I'd already turned over my second leaf a few times. And so I was going to try harder. But, you know, I was hesitant to think about turning over a new leaf because it's never worked out too good for me. I wasn't really good at turning them over. I couldn't, if I could have the presence of God with me all the time to keep me humble, there might be a shot. But on my own, I wasn't thinking it was going to work out. And thank God, He told me it won't work out. Because you know what He did? He hacked my computer again. And He brought to mind this verse. I didn't even realize it was a verse until after I started reading the Bible. But apparently, you know, they do read the Bible in Catholic churches. Do you know that? And somehow in the midst of all the candle lighting and standing up and sitting down and turning around doing the hokey pokey, I missed the message that was being read. But I thank God He didn't miss it. It embedded in my mind somehow, and Holy Spirit is able to bring to your remembrance those things that Jesus has said. And He hacked my computer, and I give Him permission to do that all the time now. You don't have to hack it. I give you the password. You just log in and just go ahead and just start talking to me however you want. And anyway, like I have to give God permission, right? But He kind of likes that. He likes to be co-workers with us. He likes to have a relationship. But he's good at introducing Himself too. Anyway, He said, "What good, if you try to save your life, you will lose it. And I realized God was not asking me to try harder or turn over a second or fifth leaf. If you try to save yourself, you're going to lose it. And so I'm humbled again. And then he goes on though and he says, but whoever loses his life for me and the gospel will find it. Now, there was a little history to that particular verse, because as a Catholic, I was serious about whatever I would do. And so I remember nailing my CCD, my Sunday school teacher, to the wall one time and saying, can we just skip the lesson? Bottom line, how do you know if you're going to go to heaven or not? And she hemmed and hawed and hemmed and hawed and said, basically, you try your best and hope it was enough. You know, but then like within 2 Sundays later, it happened on her schedule of things that it was Martyr Sunday. And the lesson started off, we know that martyrs go to heaven. And I was like, now you got my attention. Somebody can know. A martyr can know. And then this was the verse that they used to declare that we know martyrs go to heaven, because Jesus said that if you try to save your own life instead of following Him, that you will lose it. But if you lose your life for me in the gospel, you'll find it. And I was like, then I started fantasizing about getting shot on the way to church or, you know, because I didn't have much hope otherwise, you know. I had a sensitive conscience. I knew right from wrong, and I was good at breaking the Ten Commandments. I broke at least 3 of them every day, it seemed like, you know, and I started doing the math. I mean, you imagine how, you know, 3 laws, and that was just the ones that I was aware of. Forget the ones that my mom and dad never caught, you know, and the policeman never caught as I got older, all that stuff. But God saw it all and is introducing Himself to me, a rascal. I don't know how this works, except He's God and that He loves us. And some of you are sitting there, and I want to let you know, something like this might not have happened to you in this way. God has His way to introduce Himself to each one of you. You don't have to compare. There's good things about testimonies. The good thing is that you get to hear somebody's story. The bad thing about the testimony is sometimes we compare ourselves with one another. Well, that didn't happen to me. Well, Paul had Jesus personally appear to him. That didn't happen to me, but guess what? I still got saved. Some of you never had anything like this happen to you. But you know what? The Word of God says when you hear the gospel and believe on the gospel, that you will be saved. When you call on the name of the Lord, when you turn your heart to Jesus, when you turn away from going your own way. And I was just so thick-headed, God had to do it Himself. He had to lead me to Himself on His own. Apparently, I was too prideful to accept that kind of a conversation with another human being. Or maybe I was like Paul, so hard-headed and wicked that I was going to hurt whoever tried to come close to me. I don't know what it was, but I'm thankful for it. Whoever saves his life, tries to save his life, will lose it, but whoever loses his life for me and the gospel will find it. Thank God for that. I wanted life, and I realized He was talking about a life that I wasn't born with. I had life already, right? But I had a life that my mom and dad gave me. Jesus is talking to me about life that He can give me, a life that I'm not going to have until I turn myself in. Until I say, my life is not mine anymore. I give myself over to You by faith in the gospel. That You, the good news, that You sent Your Son to live life for me. A righteous life for me. I couldn't do it. I love it when somebody else does the hard work for me. You guys like that? Sometimes we're trying so hard to make ourselves right with God. Then God looks down and says, son, just go do it for Him. Man, that is good news, isn't it? Jesus lived a righteous life on our behalf. He's already, as the Son of God, He's already completely righteous. He's already completely victorious. He's got all authority. But He didn't do this for Him. He did this for us. And that's such an awesome thing. So he lived for us, and he not only lived for us, he died for us. Y'all know that. You can't hardly live in America and not know that. Why did Jesus die? For us? Yeah, he died for us. But why for us? That's an amazing thing. He did it. I don't understand why all together, but I do understand that he did it. That I needed him to take my place. Now, I'm telling my testimony, but sometimes I start to get prompted about a few things. And some of you know that Jesus died for you. All of you here probably do. You've heard that. But sometimes we hear that and it echoes in our hearts and it echoes in our mind about what sinners we are, about how bad we are. And there is an element of truth to that. Do you understand that Jesus had to die in our place and He was giving Himself a ransom to pay for our sins? The Scriptures say that He died for our sins once for all. And that is absolutely true. But you need to understand something. You don't pay more for something than it's worth to you. You go house hunting, right? When you sign on the bottom line, you've decided that that's how much that house is worth to you. Amen? I've got a car, probably soaking wet. It's worth $1,000. It's got so many miles on it. And, you know, if I got in a wreck, how much do you think that the most I would pay for that thing to get fixed would be? Maybe $1,000. After that, you start looking for other cars maybe, right? So if I'm willing to pay for it to be repaired rather than to scrap it to the junkyard, the wreck only gives me an opportunity to demonstrate how much that car is worth to me. The wreck doesn't diminish the value. The wreck becomes the occasion that I demonstrate this is how much the value is, and I pay to restore it back to its original value. Amen? And do you understand that God created us in His image? Let us make man in our image, in our likeness. And God says this. He says, love your neighbor as yourself. Do you understand that as far as God is concerned, He created us to contain and to bear His value on the earth, to be the containers of His presence. Amen? That's an amazing thing. That's why we were created empty. Because He created us as containers. Yeah. So He could pour Himself into us and pour Himself out through us. That's an amazing thing. And so that night, I just said yes. I said, that was how I prayed to receive Christ. You know, I just said, yeah, I'll give You my life. I'm yours. And I don't know what happened, but something shifted. That presence that I felt around me connected inside of me. And I knew that now God knew me, that He loves me, that things were settled. And even though but it was something different. It's that He had moved into me. And so now my life could be what He wants it to be. It's not something that I'm living trying to get into heaven. It's heaven moved into me. Isn't that cool? I don't meet God when I die. I've met Him. And now He lives inside of me so that I could be restored to that original purpose, that original destiny that He created each one of us for. And do you know what He created you for? To contain Him. To bear His image. to have Him as your image inside of yourself. And that's a lot of what we're going to be speaking about. A lot about what we're going to be talking about, because so many of us, even as Christians in the religious world, we have so much stuff going on up here that keeps us discouraged, that keeps us beat down, that keeps us confused, because we know that we get in the door by grace, right? How many of you guys know that night I went out mortal sinning, but God wasn't speaking to me about all the bad stuff that I had done? He went right to my heart to say, "You can have me if you will stop playing games with me. Do you want me? Because I want you. I don't want you to try to save your life. I want your life. I bought your life. I paid for your life. I created your life. Will you turn yourself back into me?" And you know what? So many times after then, I've said, "God, why don't you just take over?" How many of you know He don't do it, does He? You know, Jesus, take the wheel. He says, "I want to teach you how to drive." Amen? I mean, there's a sense in which He's got the owner's manual. He's got the deed to the car. Yeah, my life belongs to Him. But He's not somebody who takes over and just now all of a sudden, now I make your decisions for you and I bend your, you know, and I'm the one. He works in us both to will and to do according to His good pleasure. But there's a union. He brings our will into union with His so that we actually choose what He desires. So that there's a yes in our heart to the yes in His heart. Amen? And so we need, our mind was not meant to function independently. Our heart was not meant to function independently from God's heart. I want to talk to you about that. Tonight we're going to emphasize freedom, okay? Tonight's freedom. Tomorrow night's fullness. And then after that, what's on fire, right? Okay, so tonight we're going to talk about freedom. And the only freedom that there is, he whom the Son sets free is free indeed. I want to talk to you about how to live as sons. I want to talk to you about how to live as a son and live in freedom. So if you have a Bible, we can turn to a little passage. I like to root what I'm saying in the Scriptures a little bit at least, right? And I don't mean that. That was a little bit of a joke. Because if it doesn't come straight out of the Word of God, I don't want it. I'm all for the Spirit. But you know what? The same Spirit that lived in Jesus Christ, the same Spirit that's the Holy Spirit, is the Spirit that wrote this book. And He loves this book because this book leads people to God. All right, 2 Corinthians chapter 3. We're gonna root ourselves here for these times, and I'm with you. So is it okay if I share my testimony a little bit?
Yeah.
Okay, I want y'all to know who's up here. And then we're going to read these and move on from there. 2 Corinthians chapter 3, and I'm going to read a little bit of the context. Verse 12, Paul says, "Therefore, having such a hope, we use great boldness in our speech." I like that. And then he says, "We're not like Moses. He used to put a veil over his face so that the sons of Israel would not look intently at the end of what was fading away." So a little bit of context here. Moses would go into the presence of God and he'd get the glory of God shining on his face. And he would put a veil over his face. And the Word of God says the reason Moses put a veil over his face because he didn't want Israel to see that glory kept fading away. He wanted them to... last time they saw him, and they said, "Your face shines." And he's like, you know, and then he's like, "Okay, I want you to understand that it's not fading away. I want you to still think I'm the big man on campus a little bit." Apparently, something like that. All right? Now, and then he would go on and say this. Say, "But their mind..." 14, "But their minds were hardened, for until this very day, the reading of the Old Covenant, the same veil remains unlifted, because it's only removed in Christ." So there's something that happens here. He's talking symbolically, but there's a veil between the glory of God that was on the face of Moses. So there's a veil separating the glory of God, the gazing on the glory of God, and the people of God. In Christ, that veil is removed. God has removed the veil so that we can gaze upon His glory intently. And that glory does not fade. That glory remains. That glory transforms, is what we're going to read. But it's removed. Where? In Christ. In Him, it's removed. Praise the Lord. Isn't that good?
Yes.
Okay, now. But to this day, when Moses is read, a veil lies over their heart. But whenever a person does what? Turns to the Lord. Isn't that good? Whenever a person turns to the Lord, this veil is taken away. So many of us are trying to, when we have an issue in our walk with God, what ends up happening? We start analyzing our feelings. We start analyzing ourselves. We get all these thoughts pinging around. We get these feelings pinging around. And we try to use the Bible to sort all that stuff out. And it's good to use the Scriptures. But the problem is, we forget to turn to the Lord directly. We try to fix ourselves. We try to by using the truth. We try to become our own psychiatrists and our own counselors. And we need to once again gaze upon Jesus and turn to Him directly and interact with Him and see Him clearly. And so we're going to talk about that, because sometimes people think that they're turning to the Lord and they're turning to their concept of the Lord that's been warped. It's not really Him. And so I want to help us see Him really clear. Okay? It's my favorite thing to do. To me, my ministry is about Jesus. I love Him. He's captured my heart. And I want y'all to love Him. I want you to know Him. He set me free from so much. He set me free from everything. And I'm still learning to walk it out. And it's really fun. It's really fun. I just got off the phone, actually. We still hadn't got to the verses we were going to camp on, but I just got off the phone with a man. I met him maybe 2 months ago, and we had a half a day together. It was with a small group in a house, and I just shared with him a little bit in the morning time, and then at lunchtime we had a big long lunch break. And I said, now, just go out. Don't put any pressure on yourself, but I want you just to let the love that you've received this morning, I want you to begin to love other people with that love. Let God be a co-worker with God. Just love them. Don't be a gimmicky thing. You're not trying to, you know, preach the gospel at people. I want you to be the gospel to people. Amen. And you don't quite understand that yet, but I want you, you might understand it a lot, but I just, we're so eager to lead people to Christ instead of be Christ to people.
Yes.
Because that's who we are. We are the image bearers of God. Christ dwells in us. We are His body. So when people encounter us, are they encountering a bunch of theological jibber jabber about Jesus, or are they actually encountering Him in us? And if we're filled with theological jibber jabber and pressure and principles and rules and all these things that we think we're supposed to do because the Bible says it, but we've got no living connection, we've got no present gaze upon the glory of God, we don't see that, because what we see is what fills us. Amen? Jesus didn't live out of a bunch of understanding of principles. He said the Son can only do what He sees the Father doing. I'm only speaking what I've heard from my Father. He said, my whole life is the overflow and the echo, and I'm a loudspeaker from this relationship that's reverberating inside of me. It's just coming out. This is what I hear and what I see. And so we need to know God as a person in Christ. We need to see His glory, and that's what God wants for us. But what we tend to do, and I'm not bashing anybody, you understand that. So, but I went to seminary, but I have to tell you, what I learned in seminary was how to draw principles out of this book and how to teach you principles to live by and how to apply this to your life and how to apply that to your life and how to apply this to your life. And so we end up teaching the Christian life as you've got to live it, guys. And so here's how you do it. And this book is a bunch of advice and principles for you to apply to your life. Well, welcome to the victorious Muslim life. Because that's all you get if you're in Islam. You get a book from God. This is what I like. This is what I don't like. You're going to get hellfire forever if you don't do it. And 70 virgins if you do it. Congratulations. That's the way most people look at the Christian life. But Jesus said this. John chapter 5, He said, I think it's 38 through 40, somewhere there. He said, you search the Scriptures because you think that in them you have life. But it's these that bear witness of Me. Yet you won't come to Me so that you might have life. Do you understand that Jesus came into this world as a son, demonstrating to us what we were created to be? We were created to be sons of the living God. We were created to be containers of the life, the divine nature of God. So Jesus said, when you see Me, you don't even see Me. You see the Father. Because I'm not the one doing the living. I'm the one containing the life. I'm like a water bottle. And you're getting splashed all the time. But it's not Me. I'm pouring out what I contain. And what I contain is not a what, but it's a who. It's a Him. And He's awesome and He's glorious. And He created you for this very same thing. And yet, so many times we want to do the living. And so Jesus told His disciples, He said, the first step in discipleship is forget about you. You bring nothing to the table whatsoever. Don't try to do this. This is not about you. It's not from you. It's not for you. You start this life by dying. It's the end of you. Into the flesh, that sounds really harsh. But when you realize what's in your flesh, it sounds really cool. Because how many of you know that sometimes people realize that they are the problem and they get tempted with suicide? If I could just get rid of me, then everything's going to be fine. And that's a deception. Amen? Yes. In some ways. But in one way, it's really not, because intuitively we know we've got to get rid of us, and the problem is not everybody else around us. And these things that are in us are so deeply rooted. Unless I die, I'm never going to be fixed. And so guess what? Jesus says, I will become one with them. I will bear them inside of Me so that when I'm crucified, I will actually take them to the cross. And Jesus didn't just die for you, He died as you. And when He died, the Father says yes to Him representing you and Me forever. And so guess what? In the mind of God and how He really sees it, that when Jesus died, He didn't just die for your sins. You died too. You died to sin. You died completely. That was the end of Adam's race. He is the last Adam. You understand that? Yeah. So like, if the ark went down, we'd all gone down inside of Noah because we were all inside of him. Right? Amen? You understand that? When Adam was taken captive by the powers of darkness, when he bowed the knee to Satan and his lies, do you know what happened? The whole human race was inside of him. God lost his image bearers to Satan. We got taken captive. We were held hostage. Satan was booted out of heaven for his rebellion. He wanted to be worshipped by men and angels instead of to worship God. When God said, "Let all the angels serve him," right? Satan said, "I will exalt myself. I will not serve your image bearers made of dust." And guess what? There wasn't even a big battle in heaven. God just said, he's done. Rubbing his tail, lands in the garden. Why? Because there was that one place left in the universe, the one place in the entire created realm, invisible, invisible, where there were the intersection of the two realms, right? But on earth, in the visibles, the man had been given dominion. Genesis chapter 1, verse 26 and 27. "Let us make man in our image and let him be, demonstrate our likeness and let him rule." Let them rule. He's put us in charge. Do you understand? When God created you and me, He created us to be rulers. That's why he won't take over. He said, "Let them rule." But God was giving Adam, through fellowship and through union in the Spirit, He was giving Adam that everything he needed to demonstrate God when he ruled. Not ruling over other people, which is what we try to do. That's what Satan does, right? But this is using the rule and the authority like Jesus did to set the captives free, to maintain freedom. Amen?
Amen.
Because the dominion of God coming under His authority sets us free from every false authority. The truth sets us free from every lie. And Jesus is the truth. Who is free as a son and brings us into that freedom as sons. Amen? The reason Jesus is able to get people free in their souls is because of He is the truth. The reason He's able to get people free in their bodies is because He is the Son with the authority. Amen? He didn't say this was me doing it. He didn't say I'm doing it because I'm God. He said it's my Father doing it in me. And the kingdom of God is at hand because He had surrendered all that. We'll go back to that, but I want to finish this up. So Jesus, when He steps into this world, remember we're in Adam, we're taken hostage. But as soon as God sneaks Jesus onto this planet, He snuck somebody into the cockpit of the hijacked planet. Amen? But He fooled the terrorist kidnappers because they were looking for a ruler. They were looking for a hostile takeover. They were looking for a fight. And so the way they understood power was, you know, you bring your big guns and kind of thing. They did not understand the humility of God, that God Almighty would be willing to actually step into creation as a baby, who had to come out the same way we all do, cry when he's hungry, poo on himself, need to get wiped up, had to learn to walk, had to learn to talk. You know why? And that almost sounds a little blasphemous, doesn't it? But it's not, because this is God's idea. I'm just telling you what He did. Y'all know it already. But listen, He wasn't in the womb saying, wait till I figure out how to talk, because I'm going to, you know, He had set aside His rights and powers and prerogatives as God. He had set aside the form of God, which that's what Philippians said. Although He existed as God, you know, boom. boom. Isaiah saw him, covered his eye, and saw the angels covering their eyes and covering their feet and flapping with wings, going, "Holy, holy." Why? They kept getting hit by these waves of glory coming off of him. And as amazing as he is, and as much of the stamp and the approval of heaven as he had, he came into this world and he had set all that aside. It'd be like I like to tell people, it's kind of like if the President of the United States got elected and said, "You know what? I really don't think we understand poverty in this nation. And to stamp it out, what I'm going to do is this. I'm going to, as your new president for the first 3 months of my term in office, I am going to live on the streets as a homeless man so that I can understand what this is all about. Because I'm sure we in Washington do not understand poverty." Now, during those 3 months, he's living on the streets as a homeless man. Would he not at the same time be a homeless man and the president of the United States? Same time, he's both. Amen? Is Jesus man? Yep. Is he God? Yep. But can you live as a homeless man and as the president of the United States at the same time? How many homeless men do you know that can ride on Air Force One? How many homeless men do you know that can go raid the refrigerator at the White House in the evening? How many homeless men do you know that carry a credit card in their back pocket that is paid with taxpayer dollars? How many homeless men, well, there's probably a few if Democrats get their way. Sorry, I love them. Anyway, oh gosh, please. If I just offended half the people in the room, I'm sorry. Do you understand what I'm saying? Okay? I'm not trying to make a political statement. I'm trying to make a statement about who Jesus is and what he did. You have to set aside your rights, powers, and privileges as the president to live as a homeless man. Jesus Christ set aside all of his rights, powers, and privileges as God to live as a man among men with nothing but what you and I have. Nothing. When you're born again, you have the same Spirit of God inside of you that was inside of Jesus Christ. In fact, you have the same Spirit inside of you that raised Jesus from the dead. In fact, you have the same Spirit inside of you that is still inside of Jesus Christ, because the Word of God, 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 17, says that he who belongs to the Lord is one Spirit with Him. Hey! That's cool. You know why? Because it was the Spirit of Jesus that made him awesome. Amen? I think we're ready to read the verse that I'm going to preach on. 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 17. Now, the Lord is the Spirit. And where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is what? Liberty. There's liberty. There's freedom. Amen? But we all with unveiled face, beholding as in a mirror the glory of the Lord, are being transformed into the same image from glory to glory, just as from the Lord the Spirit. This is the amazing thing to me. See, Jesus said, the Spirit has been with you. Remember, He's at the Last Supper. He's getting ready to transition up into glory. He's going to go to the cross. He's going to be raised from the dead. And He starts preparing the disciples. He said, you've known me. You've experienced me. You've heard my voice. And finally, when you see me, you've been with God. You know what He's like. It's not just a book anymore, right? The book bore witness to me. So now I'm here. And now I am the Word made flesh. But this experiential fellowship, this face-to-face, heart-to-heart relationship that we've enjoyed, it's all changing locations. It's been with you. Now He's going to be in you. Where the Lord is the Spirit. Do you understand that each one of us is being personally discipled by the resurrected Jesus from the inside? We know His voice. How? He speaks truth. Amen? He speaks love. Amen? He speaks life. Amen? And sometimes He'll hack your computer and speak English. I like that. Sometimes I get a word of knowledge. Sometimes I get a hint of knowledge. And sometimes I get a word of knowledge for dummies. You know what that is. So sometimes I've learned that God can set up communication channel. Your body is a communication center. And I remember one time going to the back part of Walmart. And as soon as the cashier came out, I got this weird twinge in my back that I don't normally get. And so I just looked at her, and it came, and then it stopped. And I was like, you get back pain, don't you? And she said, I do. How'd you know that? And I said, well, I didn't till I asked you. But the reason I asked you is because I felt like God told me. I'm still learning how to hear His voice. How about that? I'm not a big shot. He's the big shot. Amen? We got to be willing to learn. How's that happen? Well, you ever seen a toddler learn how to walk? Sometimes it ain't pretty. They just keep getting up. Eventually they stop stumbling around, and it just works out that way. Well, ended up her back got healed. Praise the Lord. Amen? And then there's other times I don't get a twinge in my back. So I just ask the cashier, how you doing standing on your feet all the time? You get any pains that give you problems like that? Because I know you got to work. You know what? Sometimes they say, well, why you ask? I said, because I want to help you. Do you have any pains? And she's sitting in, and sometimes they'll say, yeah, as a matter of fact, I got a terrible hip sciatica thing going on. I said, you ready to get rid of that? And she, oh yeah. I said, give me your hand real quick. They think I'm going to put a pill in her hand, I think. I don't know what they think. And I just grab hold of their hand and say, right now, in the name of Jesus, all pain, you come out of them. Be healed. You know, however you do it, it's not the words that you say. It's who you believe in and who you know when you say it. Amen? And so, there's a lot of different ways. And sometimes we know so much that the Holy Spirit has got to be the one to do it, that we're all bound up in waiting to be told every little thing that the Holy Spirit wants us to do, not from the Scriptures, but from special promptings. And how many of you know Holy Spirit can give you special promptings? Amen? I'm not denying that. But oftentimes what we end up doing is we say, well, we're not going to do anything until we get a prompting. Or till we get a special leading, till we get a special word, till we get a vision, till we feel flames in our hands, until we got, you know, lightning bolts shooting out of our eyes, you know, or something like that. It's because we know if somebody's going to get out of a wheelchair, you know, it's got to be God. But how many of you know the same Holy Spirit who wrote this book lives inside of you? And that's a good thing. Amen? Because this book says, go heal the sick. Woo, baby! Which ones, God? The sick. You mean just any old sickness? Yeah. What if they were born with it? Go for it. Amen? What if they've been there a long time? Go for it. Amen? What if 15 other people laid hands on them? That doesn't change my word. You heal them. That sounds to me like crazy talk. That sounds to me like freedom. Doesn't it? Because Jesus said that this is my mission, to set at liberty those that are captive, to proclaim it. But He didn't proclaim it with words only. Then He backed it up with the Spirit and with power. Amen? And that's the way it's got to be. That's why he never allowed the ministry of the church to begin until Holy Spirit arrived in power to clothe us with the power of the kingdom of God, to clothe us. And I've found some really neat things. I like to have a close personal relationship with Holy Spirit. But I've found, you know what? We misunderstand sometimes about the being led by the Holy Spirit. And we think that we need Holy Spirit to tell us every single thing to do. That's not living like a son, guys. We know our Father. And He gives us freedom to initiate. Jesus says so many times, like we have a college group. How many of y'all have ever been involved in a college group? One of the things that college students are often asking when it comes to this time of the year is, what should I do next? And is it God's will for this? And is it God's will for that? And you know what we tell them? Say, are you doing the Word? Are you pursuing becoming like Jesus Christ? Are you pursuing living out His mission for your life? To love God, to love other people, to make disciples of love, to make disciples of truth, right? To make disciples of Jesus Christ, because that's who He is. He is that. Amen? And so, are you doing that? Yeah. Are you in prayer? Yeah. Is your fellowship with God? So you're pursuing that? Then make a decision. If God hasn't told you something, go for it. He's just saying, I'm with you even to the end of the age. I'm with you. Go for it. And guess what? If you're going and you're doing everything that you know from the Word, and you need to go right, and you start to go left, how many of you know that is God's responsibility as our shepherd to lead us? He has said, I've taken that responsibility on myself. My sheep know my voice. I know your heart is to love me and to do what I want. And I'm going to lead you. How many of you know that even if you start dabbling in stuff that you shouldn't be dabbling in and start being led by the flesh a little bit, you're not. The Spirit never stops leading you, does He? He's still pulling you back into sonship. Walk as a son. That's not who you are. This is who you are. So the most miserable person on the face of the planet is not a non-Christian. It's a Christian trying to walk after the flesh. Because now, not only do you have the grief of sin and all of its entanglements, you have the grief of the Holy Spirit who will never leave you or never forsake you, that you're experiencing the echoes and the reverberations of the grief of God that you're committing adultery against with the world. Amen? He won't divorce you. But He'll be grieved. But you know what? He puts His grief aside really quickly when we turn back, because all He wants, I just want you to turn back to me. And that's what keeps people in bondage, is this veil. Is this thing that Moses put. Do you understand that God didn't put the veil on Moses? He put the glory on Moses. Amen? And He didn't put the glory on us. He put glory in us. This is the gospel. Christ inside of you. He is filled with all of the fullness of God. So you need to know that everything that God has to give you, He gave you in a person. And so often, we are trying to pursue the thing from God. And when God wants us to pursue Him, and that in Him we find everything. It's not bad to pursue spiritual gifts, right? But pursue love and the gifts, right? So what does that mean? When you're pursuing love, who are you pursuing? You are pursuing a transformed relationship with God. That's what you want. You're pursuing not just to have something, but to contain something. Amen? And that's what Jesus is. He is a container of God in the fullness. That's what we were created to be. And He knew it. Satan wants to keep you from knowing it. Amen? Sometimes we get the veil back on. We start living with this mindset of all the things that we haven't done and all the things that we're supposed to do and all the things that we should ought have done. And listen, I'm not saying that God doesn't have commands. We love His commands. But His commands are not burdensome. His commands are love me.
Yes.
And love others like I've loved you. How many of you say, no, I want to hate other people. I want to be a nasty person. You know, unfortunately, in our flesh, we decide, you know what? I could be nice, but I'm, you know. But when you say it, does God ever act like that? You know, well, I was nice the first three times, but now, you know. It sounds ridiculous to think that God would act like that, isn't it? It doesn't fit Him, does it? It doesn't fit you either. It doesn't fit me. And God has put His self inside of us so that we would wrap ourselves around Him. Contain only Him. So I tell people this when I'm out on the streets, you know, they'll say, you know, sometimes I'll just tell them, I'll say, look, Jesus died not to get your butt into a building on Sundays. He died to get everything that hell put in you out of you and to put Himself inside of you to fill you so that you will never be alone and so that He could become your source of life, your source of joy, your source of identity, your source of complete restoration. I tell people that and they go, cool. They say, well, last time I was in Pennsylvania, I had a really kind of a neat encounter. Went from Shippensburg. Remember, it was snowing that night, the last night that I was there. So I drove from Shippensburg to Lancaster, and I had to go through Harrisburg. Well, about 10 miles before Harrisburg, I started hearing this weird kind of ka-thunk, 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 ka-thunk. And then all of a sudden, in Harrisburg, I heard this ka-thunk, ka-thunk, and then it went, eek, eek. One of my windshield wipers had totally, on the passenger side, had totally disintegrated. And so now I got the little metal hook scraping across my windshield. Oh, you know, but I had to have my driver's side going because I had, you know, from Harrisburg to Lancaster to get yet. So I got where I was supposed to go. And I told them I need to pick up a windshield wiper. They said, well, on the way in, I would see a few different places to stop. And I was actually praying and just enjoying the morning. And then I realized I was getting close, and I saw a Jiffy Lube. So I pulled into the Jiffy Lube, and the guy is there, and he's got tattoos on his arm. So I said, hey, man, nice tats. I don't really like tattoos, but I like people. And if you understand? And so people said, you know, so usually if people are going to let somebody take a marker with ink and needles to their body, they put some serious thought into it, so it means something to him. So I said, hey man, nice tats. And he goes, yeah, thanks. I said, let me see him close. And he starts showing them to me. I said, man, that looks really cool. And he had this picture. It was black. It was all black and white tattoos. But he had this picture of like a brick wall. And I said, have you ever thought about reinforcing the wall with red ink? He goes, man, I've been telling my friends and they keep telling me I shouldn't. I said, man, I think that'd look awesome. And so now, you know, he's like really excited because I like his idea and I didn't even know it, you know. And anyway, so then I asked him, I said, hey, listen, so what did I do? I just started a conversation. I built a little rapport. I got outside of myself to show interest and kindness and love to him. And then all of a sudden, so I know we have rapport now. How did Jesus did this, didn't he? Hey, give me a drink. Right? He didn't start off with, you've had five husbands and you're living with somebody who's not your husband right now. You know, that might have made him look real spiritual, but it would have shut that conversation down pretty quick, didn't he? So he started off, hey, how about we just get a little conversation going? Hey, could you give me a drink? She's like, I'm not used to men talking to me, especially not Jewish men, right? So sometimes you got to break through that little stranger danger thing. Amen? So I teach people, look, you need to begin to understand who you are, and you need to forget about even caring about what other people think about you. Because that's bondage. Other people's minds is a terrible place to live your life. You were wired to have an awareness of how you are perceived and to get a sense of identity from somebody else's eyes, but you live before the eyes of one, an audience of one. Amen? And you know who God says you are. And then you live in that. And if you even have an inkling of caring about what other people perceive, it's not that you give their perceptions authority over your heart or over your actions. Amen? You are simply now just trying to decide what is the best way that I can love this person. And you use that awareness, rather than to stop you, you use that awareness to inform you. Amen? And sometimes you just loving them so hard, you just go ahead. I reached this point where I realized, you know, God's kind of made me somebody who is aware of how other people think and what other people feel. And that can be just this huge bondage. Does anybody here, you know, identify with that at all? You're like, I know what I want to say. It's like, you know, and then after a while, if you're not careful, you just pretend like, well, that's not my gift. That's not my calling. That's somebody else's thing. I want to tell you something. I have figured something out. And this is it. You ready for this, Pastor? You tell me if I'm wrong, okay? Anything in the Bible that requires commitment, that could involve challenge or change, people have figured a way out of it. And it's this. They will say it requires a special gift or a special calling. And they'll say, that's not my gift and that's not my calling. That's why nothing gets done. But I want to let you know something. Every gift of the Holy Spirit resides inside of every single believer, just waiting to be activated. There's nothing that is inside of Jesus that He has withheld from you. We've often been taught spiritual gifts as a limiting thing. Oh, what, that's your gift. It's not mine. That's your gift. It's not mine. And Paul is not teaching that in 1 Corinthians 12 and 14. That was part of what was dividing them. They were saying, they were showing off, and people were saying, hey man, look at what I can do. And then other people who haven't started doing that yet would start to feel a little bit discouraged. And so they'd look for their little thing and they'd be doing their little thing. And then after a while, but Paul says this, look, there's lots of manifestations, but it's all the same Spirit. You've got Him inside of you. So if you see it being manifest in anyone else, if you want that to build up the body, you pursue it. Amen? Some people start off and they're really good at evangelism. Some people start off really good at prophecy. Some people start off, they're really good at healing. Some people start off and they're just good at teaching. Other people are good at hospitality. It just happened. You know, they started off that way. And I've had people tell me, Andy, you're a great evangelist. You're a gifted this, you're a gifted that. And I say, gifted? Nothing. I'm not gifted. I was equipped to evangelize. I was equipped to prophesy. I was equipped to heal the sick and walk in dominion. Do you understand that? That's what the gifted ministers are to do. Apostles are to equip the church to walk apostolically, to be on mission, to understand the centrality of their union with Christ, and to walk in dominion and enforce that, the kingdom of God, wherever they go. You can do that as a housewife. You can do that as a businessman. You can do that as a garbage man. You can do it as a child. Amen? My little Phoebe back there, I'm going to tell a story and she's going to hit me probably. because she likes to. But it's an affectionate thing. All of my family, my whole family, I've never met anybody that I can't equip to walk in the power of God. It's not a special gifting thing. It's the Holy Spirit. It's a sonship thing. Jesus said, whoever believes in me will cast out demons in my name. Amen? Whoever believes in me will speak in new tongues. That's a good thing. So if you're not speaking in tongues yet, that's okay. You need to understand, this is something that Jesus said, it's a whosoever thing. A lot of times we don't get that because we've been taught we have to act, we have to pry something out of God's hand that we don't have yet. Instead of, you're a toddler, start walking. Get up, take some steps of faith so you can lay hands on people and teach them how to use what the Holy Spirit just put in them. A little different. Jesus said that whoever believes in Him will lay hands on the sick and they will recover. Amen? That's a good thing. So that means I'm not up here because I'm special. Because what I do is I teach believers to use what Jesus has given each one of us. That's my job. All right? So I started learning this about 3-4 years ago, probably, maybe four. And I start, when I learn stuff, at first, my kids were really good at finding other people for me to pray for when we would go out. You know, oh, Dad, there's somebody with a cane. Or, oh, Dad, there's somebody with a walker. Oh, Dad, there's somebody with an oxygen tank. That went on for about 6 months. And then I said, you find them, you pray for them, right? Because we're discipling people. So my little Phoebe, she's out with her mom. And Tina, she had dropped the kids off at soccer practice and decided she was going to go get some gasoline in the van. Fills up the tank with gasoline, and she says, Phoebe, do you want to wait here or do you want to come in with me? Phoebe's quiet for a moment, and she says, I'm coming in. There's somebody in there who needs prayer. And so she came in. And so Tina's like, okay, let's see what happens here, you know? We kind of like this thing. And Phoebe walks in, and she's looking around. There is nobody in that store except for the cashier. So she walks up to the counter. She was about 7 years old now. She's about 3 years younger, so she's a little bit even smaller. And she walks up to her and says, hey, how are you? And she says, I'm fine, thank you. She said, do you have any pain in your body? And she goes, well, sweetie, as a matter of fact, yeah, I have terrible back pain. And she said, I thought so. Give me your hand. And so the lady reaches out her hand and she's kind of looking confused over Phoebe's shoulder, looking at the mom like, what's going on? And Phoebe says, right now in Jesus' name, all pain you go, back be healed. And the lady says, oh, that's so cute. And she said, I'm not cute. Move around, see how it feels. So the lady moved around and then her face just dropped. She said, what'd you do? She said, you're healed, aren't you? Yeah. So then my wife had an opportunity to speak to the lady about Jesus. That when we believe in Him, He comes to live inside of us. And don't be fooled by that fact that that's just a little girl. She has Jesus living inside of her. And Jesus just touched your body because He wants you to know He loves you. He wants you to know He's real. He wants you to know that what He just did for your body, He can do for your whole life. Amen? I share that story because so many times we're so worried about stepping out. We say we believe this word, and then we let other things take away from us our freedom as sons of God. We elevate the opinions of the world, and we give them so much authority in our lives. But when we let God and God alone have complete authority, when we say like Paul, that I am compelled, I'm controlled by the love of Christ, we all want that, don't we? But I've figured out that sometimes we think we want it and we don't. Because we say we want to be controlled by the love of Christ. And that's a good thing because, you know, if the love of Christ is controlling us, that means we're free from everything except the love of Christ. His love is authority in my life. But in order for His love to control us, we must surrender to it. We must allow it to control us. And we keep messing around trying to use the love of God and let it come only to a certain point. But we need to let the love of God absolutely take over. Amen? We need to see every person through His eyes. We need to surrender our hearts to feeling about people the way God does. And it starts with allowing our hearts to understand how much God loves us. And so many of us make so many mistakes because we want to interpret how God feels about us through our circumstances. Something bad happens. Oh, what did I do wrong? He must be mad at me now. Or, why did I have such a terrible home life if God loves me so much? Or, if God loves me so much, why did He allow this to happen to my child or my friend or my husband or my wife? And we interpret God through all these circumstances. Amen? Have you seen that? Is it a temptation? It is. You know why? Because Satan is always at work in this world to try to deceive you about who you are and about who God says you are and about who God is. But Jesus comes as light into this world and into our hearts and into this meeting tonight. And He says, it's the thief that's come to steal, kill, and destroy. If you've had things stolen from you, identity, dignity, power, life stolen from you, that wasn't from God, that was the enemy. If you've had things destroyed in your life, relationships destroyed, finances destroyed, physical health destroyed, that didn't come from God. If you've had people die, loved ones taken out by different things, you need to understand it's the thief that comes to steal, to kill, and destroy. But Jesus said, if you've seen Me, you've seen the Father, and I have come that they might have life and have it abundantly. Amen? Amen. That's what God's about. And His life overcomes everything else. And He doesn't do background checks to see if you're worthy of getting healed or getting saved, does He? Jesus said, I'd love to heal you, but you have this bad attitude towards so-and-so. You need to go get that. Did He ever do that? I mean, come on, guys. This is Jerusalem unsaved. They got the law. They live in small towns. How many of you guys know that sometimes people hold grudges in small towns? Amen? But Jesus is clearing hillsides and entire villages of sickness and disease. Because the kingdom of God is at hand. God doesn't let anything that the enemy's done in your life become your identity or your value. You were created, and He created you as equal value to Himself. He loves His neighbor as Himself. He's willing to humble Himself to take on our image so that He, being made sin, we might be made into the image and likeness of God so that we could be restored into that original purpose. And when we receive that for ourselves, it sets us free from so much. It sets us free from so much. It really does. And it's got to start there. It's got to start there. And then we receive that freedom. We become containers of that love and that truth that set us free. That God didn't put that into my life. That was the enemy. But He paid in advance a high price so that He could get it out of me. So that that would not define me. So that I wouldn't be wrapped around that for the rest of my life. So that I could be wrapped around Him. Yes. Filled with Him.
Yes.
Amen?
Yes.
So I'd like for us to pray right now. And then I believe Pastor's going to share just for a second. Then we're going to have some ministry time. Because I believe that there's people here that's come in with things in their body and things in their heart that you know Jesus wants to get that out of you.
He paid an awesome high price, and I want to let you know, it's, you don't have to be worth it. You don't have to be worthy. You don't have to have enough faith. You don't have to have enough confessed up. You don't have a have to do anything. He paid in advance for you to be set free.
Amen.
Body, soul, and spirit. It's about what He's done. It's not about what you've done. And it's not about me. I'm just a believer. I'm a whosoever. But guess what? Jesus said, whoever believes in me, the works that I do, he'll do also. I like being a whosoever. That's my favorite kind of person. I like the whosoevers. So let's pray together. Just put your hands on your heart. Just close your eyes. Lord, you said so much tonight. And I believe that you're speaking right now. And you have spoken. And so we just want to say with you, Holy Spirit, we surrender. We surrender everything we are for everything that you are. You are not a spirit of fear. No shame, no guilt. You are the Spirit of the Lord with authority and power. And we thank you. Thank you for Jesus. I'd like to ask you just to repeat after me. Let's just pray together. Lord Jesus.
Lord Jesus.
Thank you for loving me.
Thank you for loving me.
Take it all. I give myself to you.
I give myself to you.
You're fully trustworthy.
You are fully trustworthy.
Fill me.
Fill me.
And set me free.
And set me free.
In Jesus' name. Amen. All right. So I want to pray for people, and I want to pray for a few different kinds of things. One, if you're here tonight and you feel like you're hearing what I'm saying, but in your heart of hearts, your heart is wrapped around something that you need taken out. you want to give it up. You're ready for that to come out. But your heart's been wrapped around something. You're struggling in your heart of hearts because you've been crushed. You've been wounded. You're still, that pain and that wound is still defining you somehow and impairing your life. You need to understand that by His stripes we are healed. That Jesus actually bore your suffering, your pain, physically, emotionally. He provided complete healing for the complete person. The other people I'd like to pray for are the people that came in here that you've got sickness and disease in your body. Okay, I'm going to do that. Now, but it doesn't do me any good to tell you you can do it and then for me to do everything, does it? Okay, so if y'all are here tonight, how many of you are believers in Jesus Christ? You're born again, okay? And you all got hands because you couldn't raise your hand. So the Word of God says believers will do what? They will lay hands. So you know what that means? That means you're fully equipped to get the job done. All right. So how many people are in here that you physically have something going on in your body that is causing you pain, discomfort that you would know immediately? Now, some of y'all have conditions that you would need to test over time. So I'm going to pray for y'all. But I want the people that you've got something, your back's hurt, your neck's hurt, your knees hurt. Every time I do this, it hurts. And doctor just said, well, don't do that anymore. You know, all that kind of stuff. That you would know I'm healed. How many of you got something like that in your going on in your body? Okay. So, okay, good. I see a few hands up. Okay. Could you keep your hands up for me? All right, good. Now, if you keep... Oh, what's up?
See, that's why God gave you a wife, to beat you. All right. Now, if you don't have your hands up and you're comfortable, you want to believe Jesus for miracles and believe that Jesus will use you, would you just get up, walk around the room, and go find somebody with their hand up? Could you do that? And I'm going to lead us through this together, okay? This is not something you're going to have to do on your own. All right? And if you got two people, if y'all could kind of maybe, sir, in a green shirt, if you could maybe stand in the aisle and then let people get over there to your wife as well. And all right. Now, if you see somebody got their hands on them, that doesn't mean you can't lay your hands on them too, okay? The more the merrier. This is a good thing. Okay. Now, I want to tell you a little story. I'm going to be real quick with this. When I went to Cambodia, I had a really great time of seeing people get healed, and I would take people out. And we went back to one of the young Christian leaders' house for lunch, and his wife had not been with us. But that morning, we had in that village seen all kinds of miracles, and everybody on the team, bar none, had seen a miracle by their hands without me involved, okay? So we were just all having a great time. And the husband, we're walking back, and he says, "Oh, by the way, my knee hurts," because his back had gotten hurt in a motorcycle accident, and that got healed. And he said, "Oh, my knee hurts too," because he's figuring it out, right? God's not on a budget. If he can heal my back, which is the big thing, you know, people try, "Well, I just want to get the big thing." You know what? How about we just let Jesus get everything he paid for? Amen? My kids, when the grandparents send the Christmas packages, they don't say, "Well, Dad, we just want the big things." We want everything in that box, Daddy. You understand that? And the grandparents would be really sad if we only gave them the big things. All right? So, anyways, so I told her, and this is what I'm going to tell you. I said, she looked at me and I said, "You're going to heal your husband." And she looked at me like, "I wasn't with you. I haven't heard what you've been saying." I said, "Don't worry. It's not a big deal. You believe in Jesus, right?" She said, "Yeah." "So you know Jesus wants your husband healed, right?" "Yes." I said, "You're his body. He lives inside of you." Okay? So he's not changed anything except locations. He can do today through you everything he could ever do. All right? And so you're going to lay hands on your husband's knee, but you're going to believe, "This is not my hand, this is the hand of Jesus Christ, because I am his body and he lives inside of me. He's attached to me. I'm his avatar." Understand that? Okay? So I want you to look at your hands. If you got your hand on somebody, you say, "This is not my hand. This is the hand of Jesus Christ. I am the body of Jesus Christ." When this hand is laid on somebody, Jesus lays hands on the sick through me. Okay? And then I told her this. I said, "And you're going to pray, but not in the way that you're used to. You're not going to talk to God about the sickness. You're going to represent God to the sickness. You're going to speak as an ambassador of Christ." How many of you know that Jesus said, "I can't do this. It's my Father doing it through me"? How many of you also know that Jesus said, "But the Son does what He sees the Father do in like manner"? And the Father's looking at the Son, and the Father's not asking somebody else to get the healing done. So the Son says, "Well, I must bear His image. So if He's not asking, if He's taking authority, I guess it's okay for me to bear that image." Amen? And guess what? That's what you see through the whole New Testament. "Silver and gold have I none, but what I have I give to you. Oh, Father, please come and touch him." Uh-uh. In Jesus' name you rise and walk. Right? So when you're going to lay hands, that's Jesus' hands, and you're going to speak, but it's not you speaking. It's Jesus speaking through you. Amen? And so we're just going to keep it real simple. So I want you to ask whoever you got your hand on, I want you to ask them this, okay? What is it that you want Jesus to change? And and those of you that are being asked, okay, what I want you to tell them is your body parts.
I don't want you to tell them how long your history's been, how, you know, many times people laid hands on you. I don't want you to tell them that I got rods in my this, and I just want you to tell them what needs to be healed. Can you do that? Because we are so quick to try to talk ourselves and other people out of miracles. And I just want to let you know, Jesus is not looking for you to make excuses for Him. He is able, ready to heal you now, because now is the time of salvation. Amen? Okay. So go ahead and just ask Him what needs to be healed. And then you... Okay. All right. Now, that should have been fairly quick. If you just had a number of things, just say, I've got a number of things, mainly this and that. Okay? I've laid hands on people's knees, and they didn't tell me about the other body parts, so you just shoot with a bazooka, okay? We're not trying to shoot with rifles and pick mosquitoes. We're just going to go ahead and just have a whole lot of collateral blessing. A whole lot of collateral healing, okay? Now this is what we're going to do. We're going to just do this together. Real simple. Just lay your hands on them, and I want you to speak with authority, okay? Just say it. Just repeat after me. Say, in the name of Jesus.
In the name of Jesus.
In the power of the Holy Spirit.
In the power of the Holy Spirit.
Everything not of God.
Everything not of God.
All pain.
All pain.
All deformity.
All deformity.
And all disease.
All disease.
You go.
You go.
Be healed.
Be healed.
Be completely healed from head to toe in Jesus' mighty name. Okay. Now, just keep your hands there for a second. And I just want you to believe God and let the power of God flow in. Okay, take your hands off. Now, if you received prayer, I want you to do something you couldn't do. Move it around. Do something you couldn't do. Somebody needs to hit Buzz Lightyear Spanish mode over there. Good. Now, three things have happened. One of three things. One is that the person who received prayer is not experiencing any sensible difference. Okay? How many? And then the other is that you've experienced some improvement, but it's not completely gone. And the other is it's completely gone. So how many of you have experienced some improvement? Okay? There's a couple. How many of you, okay, there's one, okay, good. How many of you are experiencing no perceptible change right now? I still believe God for a miracle, and I'm not trying to offend anybody, but okay. Pastors usually take at least three times. But that's not scripture, so don't build a doctrine around that. I shouldn't have even said that. Forgive me, Lord. So in Jesus' name, just make it two to prove me wrong. Amen? Okay. And then other times, people have experienced no perceptible change, and that's okay. And then others, it's complete miracles. Anybody have anything is completely gone from what you were experiencing before? Okay. Not yet. You know what we do? All right. Now here's where most Christians stop. Okay, why did you lay hands on them? Because you believed the Word of God over what was going in their body, right? Don't unplug. Don't stop. Amen? Most Christians, what they'll do is say, well, let's see if God will do anything. No. Let's don't pray and see what God will do. We look at the Word of God to determine what the will of God is. That's what God will do. Look at Jesus. We know God. Amen? We know what He does. And so, listen, if it doesn't go down the first time, if a thief breaks in your house and you hit him with a baseball bat and he still keeps coming, do you throw the baseball bat down and go, well, that didn't work? Only if you got a shotgun, right? All right, so what do we do? The power of God went in. The kingdom of God went in. And so we believe that the kingdom of God, it's like a seed that's planted when it, and it grows. And so we do the working of miracles. We tell them, do something you couldn't do. So what do you do if nothing's changed? Don't worry about it. Jesus hasn't changed either, right? So what do? You just lay hands, do the same thing. You don't go hunting and pecking for, well, have you forgiven everybody? Did Jesus ever do that? Come on, guys. We make it so complicated because we're so up into here. Jesus healed by authority and power. He has the right to get it done. Amen? That sickness and disease, we were not created to contain that stuff. Kingdom of God has showed up to get that junk out of you. And I don't care why it got in there. It's irrelevant. If a thief came in because my daughter let him in, he's still not got no right in my house. Father is here. And He's not left us as orphans. He loves you so much. Forget about all that stuff you've heard. It's causing trouble in the body of Christ. Okay? Jesus is Lord. And He loves you. And He wants you well. He's okay. So body of Christ, let's lay hands again. Let's get this completely. Everything. Alright. So right now in Jesus' name, everything not of God, I command you, go. You go. Be healed. I release life. Be healed from head to toe. In Jesus' name. Good. Now, move around, do something you couldn't do. Okay. Good. How are we doing? We need another hit. Okay. Still more improvement.
I could never come up.
Woo. Okay. All right. So it's much better, even from the first blast. Praise the Lord.
She just had surgery.
You just had surgery. Yeah, there we go. You know, I meet so many people walking with canes and they'll say, yeah, I had my hip replaced. I said, what'd they replace it with, a brick? You know? I like, Jesus does hip replacements and knee replacements a heck of a lot better than doctors do, guys. Listen, I've seen Jesus take metal parts and make them natural again. He's able to do that. All right. So let's do this again, okay? One last blast. Let's do it. All right. Now, do you guys need me to lead you? Why don't you just do it? Short, hard, forceful, like you're telling a bully to get off your kids. But I want you saying the same things. I don't want you getting fancy. Just keep it simple. It's about Jesus. All right? Let's go. Okay. Now, go ahead and move around, and I'm gonna have us do one more blast if we need to. How are we doing? How are your feet feeling?
Much better.
Okay, much better. All right, that's good. You guys didn't know that y'all were gonna be the miracle workers here tonight, did you? Did you? You didn't know how awesome you were, did you?
The chili cools are on fire. They're really hot.
Good. Okay, she's got feet on fire. Good. Good. She's... Oh my goodness. Now, I don't know many ladies with your color hair that can do that. That's good. That's good. Pastor, how you doing over here?
It's a little better.
Good, a little bit better. Okay, praise the Lord. All right, I'm going to have us do it one more time. And this is what I want you to do. Here's what I noticed, okay? As soon as we did that, I backed off of the mic and I didn't say anything. Here's what I noticed. Did y'all notice how quiet it was in here? Everybody was praying their little elevator voice prayer. You know why I noticed that? And here's why. When people Know that they have authority. They don't care who hears and they don't care what other people think. When I'm here, I represent God. Do you understand that? And so sometimes we're in this environment that we're like, we're in church and we got all these other people around. And so what? All of a sudden we go from talking real just how we normally talk. We come in, it's like, shh. You know, we might disturb somebody. I'm ready to disturb some devils, guys. Okay? So I would like you to do this. If you need to fake it, fake it. I want you to act bold. Okay? Even if you don't feel bold, because what you'll find is that Jesus Christ inside you is ready to be bold. Would you do that? Would you be earnest? Would you be serious? Would you be bold? And if you need to, just go ahead and get a little bit loud. Because sometimes, you know what? It just helps you get out of yourself. Amen?
Amen.
All right, so let's do this. One last blast.
Jesus.
All right. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. Amen. Go for it.
I believe.
Amen. 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 Good. Okay, good. Now, move around. If you've received prayer, just get up. Be bold in your steps of faith. Do something you couldn't do. Good, I like that. She's up here running. Forget this walking and prancing around. Let's stick a toe in the water to see if I'm getting healed. The Word of God says I am healed. Amen? That's good.
Yeah.
Oh, good.
They're on fire, so it's all, you know.
Amen. It's still working.
I'm trying to decide, is that pain or is that fire?
Uh-huh. That's good. That's good.
Yeah.
That's good. Holy Spirit's working. So we just say thank you, Lord. We just agree with that. That's good. How are you doing, ma'am?
Oh, great.
Great. Great. Good. Good.
She keeps saying, I could never do that.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. Well, that's good.